Good afternoon, colleagues. The first item of business this afternoon is Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body Question Time. I'd invite members wishing to ask a supplementary to press the request to speak button during the relevant question. And I call question number one, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Parliament Corporate Body whether it will provide an update on the efficiency of the passholder secure entry system to the Parliament in light of reports that passholders are experiencing difficulties in gaining access.
Claire Baker.
I thank the member for the question. And since April, we have had around 800 pass holders attending Parliament on business days. While I recognise there have been a few instances of pass holders experiencing difficulties, these have all been resolved. And if anyone is having persistent problems with their pass, I'd urge them to contact the pass studio. We'd be happy to discuss any particular issues with the pass holder and provide support.
John Mason.
Yeah, I thank the member for that answer. I don't know if the system actually records how often someone fails to get access, but I mean, one day last week, it took me 9 attempts. I tried each of the turnstiles twice, and it kept turning me down. And since I lodged this question, a number of colleagues, MSPs, and Parliament staff have spoken to me that they also have had similar problems. So I don't know if the advice is that I think some people have got their fingerprint removed from the pass, would be one answer, or get a new fingerprint retaken, or if there is some other way we can take this forward.
Claire Baker.
I thank the member for raising this issue. I do appreciate how frustrating it is to have intermittent difficulties with the system, and I appreciate the member raising the fact that he's spoken to other members and pass holders experiencing the same. I would encourage them in the first instance to book an appointment at the pass studio and they can check the pass. I'll also ensure that the contractor is made aware of the intermittent issues and ask if there's any upgrades which could address any potential glitches and could speed up the process.
Okay, question two, Liz Smith.
To ask the corporate body when it will next review the car parking arrangements for MSPs and staff.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. As the member will recognise, the increased security measures for the car park were recommended by Police Scotland following terrorist attacks in the UK in 2017, and the car park was updated in 2021. So while there is no intention to formally review the car parking arrangements, the operation of the car park and experience of users is constantly reviewed and monitored as we seek to balance the need for security with the ease of use for members and their staff.
Liz Smith.
Can I thank Claire Baker for that response? And SPC members will know that some time ago I wrote to the Chief Executive and to them about the difficulties encountered in both exiting and entering the car park, and at that time, fairly frequent malfunctions of the barriers which had made that entry and exit extremely slow. And things improved markedly, mainly as a result of careful and judicious manual operation of the entry and exit system. But in recent weeks, the process has again been exceptionally slow, although I think I have to say I think it's been a little better in recent days. Could I just get confirmation, which I think will be of interest to many other members, that the more efficient manual operation will be in place from now on so as to avoid the lengthy delays, especially underground when several cars and motorbikes are waiting with the resulting car fumes that entails.
Claire Baker.
I thank the member for the question. I understand that she has a letter with corporate body at the moment and will respond as soon as possible. It is fair to say there have been teething problems with the vehicle entry system, and these have been dealt with by facilities management and the contractors. The member is asking if we intend to remain in manual mode. I would have to say that isn't the intention, that the more secure operation is to work it as it should be operated. There is one outstanding issue to resolve with the V-entry gates, that's in the induction loop system. Work to resolve this will be disruptive. The plans are to take it forward during the summer recess. This will lead to a reduction in the need to operate in manual mode and restore the integrity of the system. And it is about ensuring we have the level of security that is required. I know that's maybe not the answer the member looks for, but it is it's an intention to move away from operating in manual mode.
Question three, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body what action it takes to ensure that children and young people from across Scotland can visit their Scottish Parliament.
Christine Graham.
I thank the member for her question. SPCB provides a school engagement programme through its Public Engagement Services Office. We offer schools free sessions and hours at the Parliament. Understandably, COVID changed things for schools and our service. We now have a digital school service as well as restarting our team who visit schools across Scotland. These services are popular and especially appreciated by those who don't want to travel to Edinburgh or for a number of reasons find coming to Edinburgh to be too challenging. Across our services, we have reached schools in 69 out of 73 constituencies, and we are continuing to improve ways of maximising our engagement with schools. Children and young people also visit the Parliament to take part in committee meetings, meet their MSPs and our engaging events programme.
Ruth Maguire.
I thank Christine Graham for that answer and appreciate the good work that the Parliament do and the education team. Members will, like me, have visited schools in their own constituencies and seen the interest that children have in the workings of our Parliament. I've been disappointed on the last number of occasions that the young children that I've visited haven't been able to visit Parliament due to cost constraints. They find the cost of transport very expensive. Is there anything that the Scottish Parliament can do to assist pupils in less well-off areas or perhaps those in rural areas who find the travel to Parliament too costly?
Christine Graham.
I thank the member for a supplementary. We are continuing to review how best to deliver our education services in the most effective and inclusive way post-COVID. It is important to the SPCB that we can ensure equity and meet the aims of our public engagement strategy to break down barriers for those least likely to engage with us, and that we take into account other commitments, such as reaching net zero and ensuring most effective use of our resources. There are many factors around distance travelled and deprivation that we would want to consider. From our evaluation forms, we know 25% of schools say cost is a factor. To date, the SPCB's approach for those who can't travel to Edinburgh to visit us has been to provide targeted services in schools. Our outreach and digital services are popular and remove other significant barriers, such as time away from the classroom. The SPCB is happy to explore whether, as part of this review, offering some sort of subsidy is within its power and helpful to meet our engagement goals of inclusivity. It's important we consider the feasibility of any subsidy within the context of reviewing our education service as a whole in the context of our wider corporate commitments, including public engagement and sustainability. We will ask officials to engage with schools from across Scotland and look to other legislatures to ensure any decision takes account of the needs of schools alongside our service capacity to support these needs.
Supplementary, Stephen Kerr.
Yeah, thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I wonder if I can ask Christine Graham and the corporate body whether or not in the recent memory of the institution there has been any attempt to organise a parliamentary week or a parliamentary fortnight across all of the schools in Scotland that would then allow us to promote the activities, the work that goes on in this Parliament. So in effect, reverse the situation that has been described previously in relation to visits, but actually taking the Parliament, as it were, into the classrooms of Scotland.
Christine Graham.
Yes, I thank Mr Kerr for his supplementary. Well, I think in my answers I've given it, the endeavour to do this all the year round, but this is a specific question he's asking me, and I'm happy to make inquiry into this with the corporate body and report back to him.
And question four, Stephen Kerr.
To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body what the newest developments are in the creation of Scottish Parliament apps to allow the public easier access to parliamentary papers and other resources.
Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, and I thank the member for that question. The corporate body does not develop mobile applications ourselves. However, we do utilise several mobile apps to help deliver services to the public. The latest development in this area involves officials working with suppliers to establish how we can bring access to broadcasting material via an app which will be available to the public to download. This app will allow the viewing of live proceedings as well as archived material. The main source of information about parliamentary proceedings remains the website. This has been designed to be accessible and compatible across different types of devices, including mobile phones and tablets. Members of the public with any device with a web browser and internet connection will be able to access all parliamentary business papers and other resources from this website.
Stephen Kerr.
Yeah, I just don't happen to think that that is the satisfactory line that we should be taking. Because the corporate body will be aware of my very keen interest in the matter of apps that you can download from all of the various stores that exist. But I do welcome the fact that Maggie Chapman's been able to tell me that there is work ongoing on a broadcast app, which I do welcome. I think we should all be motivated to want to try and make it easier for the people of Scotland to access this Parliament and view its proceedings. So I wonder if I can ask Maggie Chapman to give me a couple of assurances. First, when we're developing these apps, will there also be space in that development work to create access to business papers, the official report? Will there be a digital annunciator that would allow someone that accesses the app to see what the current business of the Parliament is, who's speaking at any one time, what's being debated? And will there be, in the app that she's already mentioned in her first answer to me, a single-click access in the app to allow viewing of live broadcast? Because one of the problems with the website access to Scottish Parliament TV is there are too many clicks and it's too difficult to find. And my second question is it possible to say if a pilot version of the app she's described or the app I'm describing might be possible to be trialled later this year?
Maggie Chapman.
I thank Stephen Kerr for that supplementary, and I take his point about the multiple clicks that you often have to go through on the website. That is something that we can take back to the web developers and maintainers to see if we can make that a much more streamlined process. On the specific questions of different apps, one of the reasons we don't go down the route of having different apps that members of the public and indeed members have to download from the App Store, from Google Play, from other providers, is because that will require constant interaction and engagement with those providers to ensure updates are compatible with our systems, that our systems are compatible with those apps, including security concerns. So that's one of the fundamental reasons why that isn't the preferred method of app provision for systems within the Parliament, whether that's for our own use as members or for the public. However, I hear what he says about the business papers, the digital annunciator as well, and we can certainly take those forward into conversations we have about this. In terms of the pilot scheme, I think that would be something that I'd have to come back to Mr. Kerr on. I'm not sure exactly at the stage how far developments are, but I do know that Mr. Kerr is meeting with our head of digital services next week, and I'm sure he can pick up some of those points as well.
Thank you, Ms. Chapman. That concludes Scottish Parliament corporate body questions. There will be a brief pause while the front benches change before we move on to the next item of business.